Thank you. So you're a tough guy, like you're really rough Bad guy. Duh. There we go. So, welcome to the stream. Who exactly is in the audience, by the way? I see sushi and how's it going? Whitaker is here with me as well. He's like a math genius. How's it going, Steph? Is the audio okay? And then also, can you all hear me? I mean, like, can you see me? Okay. On my side, it's a little wonky. There we go. So let's see. I guess before we get started, since we do have one new person in the audience, we can do just like a brief review of what we did last time, what we're up to, and then we can get started.
That sounds good.
Let's see. I know Steph was here last time. So for sushi, basically what our plan is to kind of go through this book. It's a logic book. Because this math professor, the math sorcerer, says that it's probably one of the best books to start with if we're trying to learn like all of mathematics. Good. So let me play this 40-second clip here.
So this first book, I already did a review on, actually just recently. It's Discrete Mathematics with Applications by Susanna Epp. This is an extremely good beginner book, and you can get a used copy for a few dollars. This will let you get started with the theory of logic. So you'll learn about like logical implications, truth tables, all kinds of things regarding, basic mathematical logic. And the beautiful thing is you need zero algebra to learn this. Now, you will have to learn algebra at some point, and I'll show you later in the video, but you can start with this. You can start by learning like the core foundations of mathematics. It's really, really quite beautiful. So this
So, hopefully that makes math a lot more fun if we start from basic logic. And then just the second thing that we kind of looked at was how do you learn all this math and actually like remember it all? I know you and stuff are actually really good at math, but like I tried reading a math book once and it just like went in one ear and went out the other ear. And I read the entire book. So this guy kind of talks about like how you can encode it into your brain for more long-term use. So let's see what he says.
And so someone that has done a high level of encoding, when they explain something, it sounds very simple. And you can often get that feeling of like, wow, I never thought of it that simply before. And they can do the classic kind of explaining it to a 5-year-old or explaining it to a 10-year-old. And that is a sign generally of someone having a higher order of learning. So How do we know what higher order learning is? There are two different frameworks that we can use to understand this. The first one is called Bloom's taxonomy. And as you can see, the lower order learning is really the stuff at the bottom levels, the remembering and the understanding. A lot of people will say that just memorizing something is not real learning. Understanding is when you're getting real learning. That's not true, because understanding something is still very isolated. When we're doing good encoding, we never want information to be isolated. And so someone that has...
So, I mean, I guess you can correct me if I'm wrong, but like the way I understood this is we kind of want to spend most of our time up here, maybe like discussing the stuff that we're talking about. And that'll help us remember it longer versus just kind of like doing drills, the kind of stuff you would do alone, the boring stuff that scares people away. Apparently it doesn't even last in your brain as long. So that's kind of how I got that. So we'll kind of treat the math book like it's a piece of philosophy. So we can discuss, you know, one concept for the whole session if you guys want to. That would benefit us. It would take longer, but then we'd have to study less, so it would actually save us time, you know, theoretically. Why'd you get into math in particular, by the way? It's cool. I'm just curious.
Oh, great question.
Really? Let's see. Whitaker, why did you get into math? Maybe you should answer first.
Well, I guess in college, I just took a couple math classes for fun, and I just really appreciated kind of the beauty of the subject, this process of developing this logical world, like this these logical structures where each concept built on the previous one. I just like those sorts of abstract logical structures, and I just liked it, but I particularly enjoyed the process of doing mathematical proofs, and of giving a rigorous argument for why a mathematical statement is true. I just found that to be just enjoyable in its own right because of the beauty of the logical structure. And also, it was a good way of kind of just exercising general reasoning skills. Like, I found that doing mathematical proofs enables me to think more precisely in all sorts of other areas of life, like whether philosophy or other subjects. Because like all sorts of like in all areas of life, people make arguments and try to justify their claims. So I found kind of that experience of really, really making claims precise and making arguments very rigorous, like in the context of mathematical proof. So I found that to be something that was very applicable very broadly.
Hmm. What about you, Sushi? Why are you into math? I didn't ask Steph this. I'm kind of curious. I know he's more pragmatic. But yeah, if you're into math, Sushi. And then I'll try to give my answer. Let's see. So Sushi's been doing math competitions since she was 5.
Oh, that's impressive.
Just kept going with it, and it was easy for me in school. So Steph says, I don't know. I just execute it. Really, since I solve puzzles most of the time. Interesting. I guess you guys are like naturals. I know that sometimes naturals like be into math just because Let's see. For me, I have a theory. I think it makes you smarter to study logic. So even if you're like an average Joe, it would still be helpful to you. Even if you're not gonna be an engineer or something, it'd still make life easier for you. I know people are technically people are apes, right? Well, we're so smart now that you can hardly tell, but we're supposed to be primates, and primates have like a mathematical intuition, which I think can be honed and trained. If you were to show a monkey two different amounts of food, they'd be able to tell you which one has more. Or if you kind of show them a screen with a program, they can point to the groups on the screen that have the most or the least. So humans are kind of similar, except I think our mathematical intuition is 10 times more intense. So even like a young child, if you were to go into their room, be monkey, yeah, right. After they clean, you would see that they organized everything in kind of like a logical way. Like they got the shoes stacked over here, they have their clothes, their pants hanged up in the pants section. Indeed, we are. We don't have to return to monkeys. We are monkeys technically, I think. But yeah, I think it can be trained. And yeah. Mine's gotten pretty rusty. Like at one point, I think if a middle schooler asked me to do their homework, I don't think I'd be able to handle it. 12 divided by 5, just be stuck. Couldn't help you. I would like to fix that. Yeah, I know the bee monkey. Return to monkey. Also, we have this whiteboard. I don't know if we'll need it this time, but we'll see. Which, some genius artist crashed the whiteboard. With these awesome pictures. I'm not even sure how
Oh,
you.
yeah. Yeah,
But
those are amazing.
we'll use a whiteboard at some point later. And then there's also a interactive notepad, which we'll probably use this time. And the links are in the description for these. Because I will test you guys, even though you're both more advanced than I am. We'll see. Or all three of you, I should say, because Whitaker is up there as well. No. Last time, we looked at some of these symbols. And, we could look at all of these symbols. These would be all the mathematical symbols that are going to show up in the book. So if we know what all these are, we're pretty much good. But I think it might be a better use of time to just look at the ones that we're going to actually touch on today. And that would actually be none of them, because the elements start here at page 7, but the first few pages are just talking about variables in general. So we might just jump in, I think. My brain is empty at all times, so maybe that's the secret to being super good at math. Just hella empty mind, I guess, I suppose. So let's see. The strategy here is Whitaker and I will probably just read a few chunks of this, and then when we get to these examples, we'll hit the interactive notepad, the interactive whiteboard, and I'll see if you guys can do it. If you guys can't, then I'll try and do it myself. And we'll just progress that way. The streams last usually about an hour and 30 minutes to 2 hours. You don't have to stay for the whole thing, but that's about as long as we'll go. So let's see. What do you guys think about that? Cool, cool.
That sounds good.
Now let's see. You want to start or me, Whitaker?
I guess I'll start. So therefore, our students study mathematics and do not build without foundations. Leonardo da Vinci. The aim of the this book is to introduce you to a mathematical way of thinking that can serve you in a wide variety of situations. Often when you start work on a mathematical problem, you may have only a vague sense of how to proceed. You may begin by looking at examples, drawing pictures, playing around with notation, reading the problem to focus on more of its details, and so forth. The closer you get to a solution, however, the more your thinking has to crystallize, and the more you need to understand, the more you need language that expresses mathematical ideas clearly, precisely, and unambiguously. This chapter will introduce you to some of the special language that is a foundation for much mathematical thought, the language of variables, sets, relations, and functions. Think of the chapter like the exercises you would do before an important sporting event. Its goal is to warm up your mental muscles so that you can do your best.
Okay. So let's see, one, variables. A variable is sometimes thought of as a mathematical John Doe. Hey, there you go. Because you can use it as a placeholder when you want to talk about something, but either one, you imagine that it has one or more values, but you don't know what they are, or two, you want whatever you say about it to be equally true for all elements in a given set. And so you don't want to be restricted to considering only a particular concrete value for it. To illustrate the first use, consider asking, is there a number with the following property? Doubling it and adding 3 gives the same result as squaring it. In this sentence, you can introduce a variable to replace the potentially ambiguous word it. Is there a number x with the property that 2x plus 3 equals x squared? Yeah, I guess that is clearer. The advantage of using a variable is that it allows you to give a temporary name to what you are seeking so that you can perform concrete computations with it to help discover its possible values. To emphasize the role of a variable as a placeholder, you might write the following. Is there a number blank with the property that 2 times blank plus 3 equals blank squared? The emptiness of the box can help you imagine filling it in with a variety of different values, some of which might make the two sides equal, and others of which might not. To illustrate the second use of variables, consider the statement, no matter what number might be chosen, if it's greater than 2, then its square is greater than 4. In this case, introducing a variable to give a temporary name to the arbitrary number you might choose enables you to maintain the generality of the statement, and replacing all instances of the word it by the name of the variable ensures that possible ambiguity is avoided. No matter what number n might be chosen, if n is greater than 2, then n squared is greater than 4. I do understand that a lot more. So now let's see here.
First example.
Right. I looked at these examples. They are a little tricky, you know. Well, let's see here. So use variables to rewrite the following sentences more formally. Are there numbers with the property that the sum of their squares equals the square of their sum. And then, given any real number, its square is non-negative. So they just want us to throw in variables into these sentences to make them more like this, easier to understand because there's a variable there. So now I ask you guys in the audience, like, did you grasp any of that? I also kind of have a fear that like reading it might make it difficult for people to grasp because they'll just kind of like go in one ear and like leave out the other. So I wonder, what was it like for you guys? Did you understand the variables? Yeah, kinda. Okay, that's good. It's like a 6 out of 10. Well, we can make the understanding more concrete if we, I guess if we hit the whiteboard. Let's see. You think this is a good one to hit the whiteboard for? Or you think it's going to be too messy?
We could do it on the whiteboard. Variable is a placeholder. Yeah, that's the idea. It's kind of like there are a couple contexts in which you could use a variable. Maybe you don't know the value of something, but you want to talk about it. And so until you know the value, you just give it this name like n or x, and then use that as a placeholder until you find the value. And then another context is like if you're talking in the abstract about like all real numbers have this property, then you can say like for any real number x, this thing is true about it, like x squared is or like a x plus 1 is greater than x. So it's kind of a convenient notation, both for like a placeholder for some unknown value, and also a placeholder for like any value in some set. So like if you say like for every real number x, x plus 1 is greater than x, you're using x as a placeholder that you could fill in with any real number and the statement would be true. So it is a placeholder exactly. And it's useful to have variables because they allow you to talking about things using symbols rather than words is going to be useful in proofs because then you're better able to do kind of algebraic manipulations and things like that. And able to make your reasoning more precise.
What was that example you gave? For any real number, that number plus one is what?
Is greater than itself, x plus 1 is greater than x. Yeah, which I guess is like a of course it is, but yeah, any real number, if you add 1 to it, you get something greater.
So let's see, one of the examples like they want us to do, I think was like an easier one. Since sushi is new, I'll give sushi this easier one. So sushi, you know how to access this notepad here? Should be in the description.
Yeah, it's below whiteboard. It's the second link.
And then I'll give Steph the hard one. To be honest, like when I look at this hard one, I don't even know how to answer it like the way that they want me to answer it. So we'll let Steph give it a try. And then you can try as well, Whitaker, unless you already looked at the solution.
Yeah, not yet. I haven't looked at it yet. But try those out and see what you get.
So let's see here.
Yeah, non-negative, by the way. I think Sushi's doing the first one, right? The given any real number, its square is non-negative.
Yes.
Yeah, so the first one, given any real number, its square is non-negative. And non-negative, by the way, So that means not negative, so like it's either zero or a positive number. And the idea is to like take these statements and insert variables into them, so that it's so that you're saying something like expressing it in terms of the variables rather than fully in words.
Any real number x.
Yeah, for any real number x, that's how it would start. Then x is gonna have some property. And it wouldn't quite be root x, but like the other way around, like x squared.
Right.
Yeah. So for any real number x, it's gonna have this property. Its square is non-negative. And yeah, you're exactly right that to be non-negative means that it's greater than or equal to zero. That's what it would be if it's not a negative number, either positive or zero. Yeah, and exactly. Its square would be x squared. Yeah. So x squared is greater than or equal to zero.
Nice. Yeah, survived the test, Tushy. Now, Steph, do you want to try and give this one a go? If you're still there, that is. Otherwise, I can try and tackle it. Sum of their squares. Square of their sums.
So the sum.
We're gonna need parentheses. Well, parentheses would probably help here, right?
Yeah.
Are there numbers? What I don't like about this question is that it says, are there numbers? And that doesn't tell you how many numbers they want us to work with here. I really hate that.
Oh yeah. It is ambiguous because like it could be like are there 100 numbers, right, such that the sum of their squares equal.
So I'll help you out and throw that in because that's what they mean.
Yeah.
Knee jerk reaction is zero. I think I know this. Well, yeah. When we throw this in there, it's a little less confusing than it was this two. So, are there two numbers with the property that the sum of their squares equals the square of their sum? You don't have to answer the question. You just have to transform the question to use these variables to make it, you know, like more readable.
Yeah. So like think about how it worked for the first one. So given any real number, it has this property. So we had for any real number x, so you give a name to some generic real number and then say something in terms of that variable. And then in this case, we're going to need two variables because we're asking like, are there two numbers that have this property? So you could say like, are there two numbers x and y with the property that Then we need to figure out how to say the sum of their squares equals the square of their sum.
Don't give them the whole answer.
Yeah. Yeah, so that part of them. See if you can figure that out. Sum of their squares equals the square of their sum. You can maybe take it bit by bit. Like, how would you express the sum of their squares, like, in terms of the two numbers x and y?
The sum of their squares.
yeah, definitely. It is challenging, particularly the wording is kind of very compact, and yeah, these are definitely challenging ones to start out with right off the bat.
Let's see. X squared plus y squared. Okay, so that is the sum of their squares equals the square of their sum. That looks awesome. Right. Who wrote that? Okay.
Yeah. Excellent.
Correct. Told you, like, the first question that they throw at us is kind of tough. Let's see.
Yeah, that was very, very well done.
All right, you guys survived. Let's see here. Yep, this is exactly what Stuff said. And then this is sort of what she said, although they kind of tricked us with the was this greater than or equal to? Oh, because non-negative includes zero. Oh wait, but I think that is what she wrote actually. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, the greater than plus an equal to sign.
Wow, you guys are sharp. You guys are the real deal.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Let's move on. I think it might get more complicated eventually. So let's see here.
Yeah. So I guess I can read this part. So three of the most important kinds of sentences in mathematics are universal statements, conditional statements, and existential statements. Universal statement says that a certain property is true for all elements in a set, but where a set, they're going to get to sets in the next lesson, but a set is just a collection of things. So like a set could be the set of all real numbers, for example. A certain property is true for all elements in a set. For example, all positive numbers are greater than zero. A conditional statement says that if one thing is true, then some other thing also has to be true. For example, if 378 is divisible by 18, then 378 is divisible by 6. Given a property that may or may not be true, an existential statement says that there is at least one thing for which the property is true. For example, there is a prime number that is even. Yeah, so we have three kinds of statements. One universal statement says that like all things of a certain kind have some property. A conditional statement like if this is true, then that is true. An existential statement, there is something that has this property. Yeah, so those will be important kinds of statements in math.
Okay.
Yeah, and in later sections, we will define each kind of statement carefully and discuss all of them in detail. The aim here is for you to realize that combinations of these statements can be expressed in a variety of different ways. One way uses ordinary everyday language, and another expresses the statement using one or more variables. The exercises are designed to help you start becoming comfortable in translating from one way to another. Yeah, so we're going to look at how some kind of ordinary, like ordinary English statements translate into more precise statements using variables.
Okay. Universal conditional statements. Universal statements contain some variation of the words for all, and conditional statements contain versions of the words if, then. A universal conditional statement is a statement that is both universal and conditional. Here's an example. For all animals A, if A is a dog, then A is a mammal. One of the most important facts about universal conditional statements is that they can be rewritten in ways that make them appear to be purely universal or purely conditional. For example, the previous statement can be rewritten in a way that makes its conditional nature explicit, but its universal nature implicit. So, if A is a dog, then A is a mammal. Or, if an animal is a dog, then the animal is a mammal. Okay. The statement can also be expressed so as to make its universal nature explicit and its conditional nature implicit. So, for all dogs A, A is a mammal. Or, all dogs are mammals. Interesting. The crucial point is that the ability to translate among various ways of expressing universal conditional statements is enormously useful for doing mathematics in many parts of computer science. So we're going to get to dig into that with these examples. Where's the solution here? Okay.
Yeah.
So, fill in the blanks to rewrite the following statement. For all real numbers x, if x is non-zero, then x squared is positive. So let's see here. If a real number is non-zero, then its square you have to do this for programming. I wonder, like, with this particular book or this particular exercise here.
Or just generally, like, kind of translating between different kinds of statements.
So they're actually, I think they're going easy on us with these because we don't have to rewrite the entire thing. You guys are so advanced. Which I guess makes my job easier. It's gonna carry me through the whole stream. I don't think we actually have to rewrite the statement, we just kind of fill in the blank.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Okay, Sushi, how about you do the first three and Steph, you do the last two.
Yeah. Scroll the top sentence down a little bit because it's kind of actually no, never mind. Now I see it.
Top sentence. Oh, I see.
Oh no, I got it. Yeah, my screen. I just had it down.
Real numbers would be an equivalent way. For all real numbers x, if x is non-zero, then x squared is positive. If a real number is non-zero, then its square is positive. That seems right.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe like maybe stuff you can try out the next one, for all real non-zero real numbers x blank.
Okay, yeah, I guess we can just oscillate. Oh wait, I think stuff is probably gonna do the last two.
Oh, okay. Okay, we can do that too.
The square of any non-zero real number is positive. Sounds right. All non-zero real numbers, all non-zero real numbers have. It's a pretty good one. And then that second and third one are your sushi. Yes. Their number squared do indeed be positive. There's probably a... Oh, internet went bad. Gotcha.
Yeah, that's right. They have their number squared be positive. Another way of saying that is like all real non-zero real numbers have positive squares.
Yeah, you can compress that, but... That is the correct answer.
Yeah. Yeah, and then so for the second one, like the question is like, so yeah, for all real numbers x, if x is non-zero, then x squared is positive. An equivalent way of saying that is for all non-zero real numbers x blank.
For all non-zero real numbers x, x squared is positive. Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And the third one, if x is non-zero real number. Is there a blank there too?
If x... Oh, okay, I like this one. This is really a compact... Oh, wait. I think that there's a blank here. Like this.
Oh, okay.
So, that's your sushi. That might be one of the harder ones, too. Let's see. Yep. That was my bad. There is indeed a blank there. Interesting.
Oh, yeah.
Well, let me see here.
In this case, but zero. So you're very close, but in this case, like, it would be the other way around, because the original statement says for all real numbers x, if x is non-zero, then x squared is positive. So x is non-zero should be in the if part. And then x squared is So x is non-zero, a non-zero real number should be in the if part, and then x squared is positive should be in the then part. Yeah, exactly. Yes. Yeah, so you got the elements right, but there's the other way around.
No, I have a unrelated question. Is this true? So, like, I know that it doesn't equal what they're trying to say here, right? They're saying if x is non-zero, then x squared is positive. Is it true that if x squared is positive, then x is non-zero? That was a question for you, Whitaker.
Oh, for me? It wouldn't be true, because like negative numbers squared are also positive numbers.
But negative numbers are non-zeros, right?
If x squared is positive, then x is a non-zero real number. Then in that case, mistaken for non-negative. Non-zero real number. That would be true then. Yeah, because the only thing that doesn't square to a positive real number is zero.
Okay. Nice little exercise here. But in this case, we want these to be other way around because technically it's a different statement, right? When you have the conditional flipped. Okay. Now let's see. Yep, it looks like we got through another one. Now, let's see. I'm just wondering, how are you guys in the audience feeling about the difficulty so far? On a scale of 1 to 5, like 5 being like an impossible level, and then 1 being it's kind of a breeze right now, it's kind of a cruise. What would you say the intensity is at right now? Too. It's pretty good. It's like a good warm up. Okay, let's see. Did I read the last one?
Yeah. Oh, so is it, am I up next?
Yeah, you can read this one.
Okay. So universal existential statements. A universal existential statement is a statement that is universal because its first part says that a certain property is true for all objects of a given type. And it is existential because its second part asserts the existence of something. For example, every real number has an additive inverse. So in that case, we have every real number, so that's the universal part. And then it has an additive inverse, that's telling you an additive inverse exists. So in this statement, the property has an additive inverse applies universally to all real numbers. Has an additive inverse asserts the existence of something, an additive inverse, for each real number. However, the nature of the additive inverse depends on the real number. Different real numbers have different additive inverses. Knowing that an additive inverse is a real number, you can rewrite this statement in several ways, some less formal and some more formal. Could have said, all real numbers have additive inverses. Or, for all real numbers R, there is an additive inverse for R. Or, for all real numbers R, there is a real number S, such that S is an additive inverse for R. Introducing names for the variables simplifies references and further discussion. For instance, after the third version of the statement, you might go on to write, when R is positive, S is negative. When R is negative, S is positive. And when R is zero, S is also zero. One of the most important reasons for using variables in mathematics is that it gives you the ability to refer to quantities unambiguously throughout a lengthy mathematical argument, while not restricting you to consider only specific values for them. And also, by the way, an additive inverse, that's like what you add to a real number to get zero. So like for the number one, its additive inverse would be -1, because 1 + -1 = 0. And similarly for -1, the additive inverse would be +1, because -1 + 1 = 0.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So let's see here. What was the crux of that paragraph? Universal,
yeah.
Existential statements. So, I mean, I guess we know what universal statements are, right? Like words like every or for all.
Yeah. And everything of a certain kind has some property.
The existential part is what exactly?
Yeah, so we're saying like for everything of this kind exists something. Like for every real number, there is an additive inverse for that real number. That's what that statement is saying. So the statement, it's universal because it's saying something is true of every real number, and it's existential because it says that an additive inverse exists for every real number.
Like there's at least one of something.
Yeah.
So like the additive inverse concept is like kind of like irrelevant to the heart of the concept here, right?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Like you could say like every person has a birthday, and that would also be that would also be a universal existential statement, because it would be saying for every person there is a birthday for that person.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. I'm just kind of curious, like you guys in the audience, how confident do you feel about this concept here? The universal existential statements. I already know you'll get it once we dig into it. I'm just curious to know at this point, how confident do you feel with your familiarity with it, or your grasp of it? Pretty good, huh?
Great. I'm glad to hear it.
Let's see. What about you, Steph, if you're still in there? Always have this fear when I'm reading this that people like aren't getting it at all. But I guess that's not the case. I don't know. Somewhat. Okay. That was like a grayer answer than Sushi's, so maybe we'll give you more of these this time. So what are we doing here, actually? I'm gonna blank three right this. Okay, every part has a lid.
Yeah, I'll put that part in.
Okay, Doug.
Yeah, so these are gonna be like looking for equivalent ways, other ways of saying the same thing.
Okay, let's see. How about you take the first two stuff, Mr. Stuff, and then Sushi take these. Sushi. Every pot has a lid, so. Just gotta make the statements equivalent to the original statement. Man, imagine someone who talks like this in real life. That'd be kind of cool. All pots P, there is a lid L such that. Jeez. Getting hella advanced now. I don't even think we went over this yet. There's this predicate language. For all pots P, is B and C the same? They are the same logically. Yes, they're exactly the same in terms of their logical equivalence. But I think with B, they want you to like use the variable L to kind of make the logic more explicit, use more words. With A, you can just cut straight to the chase, I think. Oh, you said is B and C the same?
Yeah, it's B. It's kind of like C, but without introducing a variable for the lid. For like, it's like C, but without the L.
Oh, really?
I think so. Like, it, for all pots P, there is, then you can just express in words what there is.
Oh, okay.
And then in C, it's more explicit, like introducing L for the lid.
So let's see. So this is your final answer then here. PL. I mean, I guess that, let's see, that would work, right? That does make sense if we
yeah, I guess they'd have to define what PL means, I guess. and I guess it would mean like L is the lid of P. L is P's lid.
Right.
Yeah, that could be like, yeah, and like a logical notation, you could have P of L for that.
Okay.
But yeah, in words, it would be like L is the lid of P, or L is P's lid.
For all pots P, there's a lid L such that L is P's lid, right?
Yeah.
All pots have a lid.
Yeah, exactly.
For all pots P, there is a lid. Short and sweet. Wait, other way around. So there is a lid L such that LP, so the pot of that lid is P. For all pots P, there is a lid L. Okay, such that the pot of that L is that P. I mean, yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Both ways probably would have made sense.
Yeah, you could also say something like lid of P equals L or something like that.
You guys are freestyling now. Oh, wait. Lid of P equals that L. Right. All right, guys, let's slow down a little bit. I think that's at least chapter 3. So let's see here. It's a lid for P. A lid for P have lids. For all parts of P, there is a lid for P. Yes, exactly. There's a lid. Okay. So far, so good. Existential universal statements. Okay, we went over universal existential statements. Now we're going over existential universal statements. An existential universal statement is a statement that is existential because its first part asserts that a certain object exists, and it's universal because its second part says that that object satisfies a certain property for all things of a certain kind. For example, there is a positive integer that is less than or equal to every positive integer. Okay. This statement is true because the number 1 is a positive integer, and it satisfies the property of being less than or equal to every positive integer. We can rewrite the statement in several ways, some less formal and some more formal. Some positive integer is less than or equal to every positive integer. Or, there is a positive integer m that is less than or equal to every positive integer. Or, there is a positive integer m such that every positive integer is greater than or equal to m. Or, there is a positive integer m with the property that for all positive integers n, m is less than or equal to n. Okay. So existential universal statements. Did that make sense to you guys? How do you feel about that in terms of confidence? I actually feel more confident about this one since we did that last one. I think I'm good. Okay. Seems like logic is your strong suit, actually. ENTP. Let's see here. Every pot has a lid. Confident. Good. You're both logicians. Okay. So there's a person in my class who is at least as old as every person in my class. A debater. Now, we did learn that debating, defending, arguing, supporting, critiquing, weighing is a higher order thinking, which means that if you do that, you remember things better. So if you debate about something, kind of defend something, kind of support, critique, it sticks in your mind for longer, and you don't have to study it as hard to remember it. So maybe that'll come in handy. Let's see here. I actually kind of like arguing too, especially when it's like, you know, good, logical, clean fight. But let's see. So for this one, how about we have Sushi do the first two then Steph do the final one. Something like this. This person in my class who's at least as old as every person in my class. This person P in my class is that P is. There's a person P in my class with property that for every person Q in my class, he is at least as old as Q. Since the person in my class, person P in my class is that P is as old as every person in my class. That P is as old.
He is as old as every... almost, just there's would be at least as old.
Yes, gotta make sure it's logically equivalent to the one that they give us.
Yeah. And by the way, it probably says like, it says at least as old rather than older, because like what if it said there is a person in my class who is older than every person in my class? Then they'd be older than themselves. So,
okay.
Yeah, it's got to be at least as old. Yeah, you're very well done.
As least old. Yes. Because it's impossible to be as old as everyone in the class unless everyone is the same age.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But it's impossible to be older than everyone in the class. I mean, I guess unless you're just not in the class, then you could be older than everyone in the class. But
true.
It's impossible for someone in the class to be older than everyone in the class.
Because they can't be older than themselves. Let's see. There's a person P in my class with the property that for every person Q in my class, P is at least as old as Q. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that hits the logical equivalence.
Yeah, very well done.
Nice, we kind of breezed through that one. Let's see.
Yeah,
at least as old as Q, at least as old as every person in my class, yes. Person in my class, yep, every person in my class. Okay. Let's see here.
Yeah, very well done.
Some of the most important mathematical concepts, such as the definition of limit of a sequence, can only be defined using phrases that are universal, existential, and conditional. And they require the use of all three phrases for all, there is, and if then. For example, if A1, A2, A3, and so on is a sequence of real numbers, saying that the limit of An as n approaches infinity is L means that for all positive real numbers epsilon, there is an integer n such that for all integers n, if n is greater than, okay, gonna need a way to differentiate these. Okay.
Yeah, a little n and big n.
I'll call this e. For all positive real numbers e, there's an integer big n such that for all integers little n, if little n is greater than big n, then negative e is less than a of n minus l, which is less than e.
Yeah, that escalated quickly in terms of the difficulty.
Interesting. Yeah, I would need to sit down and put this on paper. Now I'll have to let's see.
Yeah, that one's the one that's like not essential to understand at the moment, but it's an example of like something that'll come up later. It uses all of these different kinds of or kind of combines all three sorts of statements. But yeah, I mean, we kind of like look a little bit at like try to understand it, like, but what it means is like, so a sequence of real numbers is like, I think of it as like an infinite list of real numbers. A1 is the first one, A2 is the second one, A3 is the third one, etc. And then a sequence of real numbers can be in some, can be approaching something like if you have the sequence 1, 1 half, 1 fourth, 1 eighth, 1 16th, 1 32nd, etc.
It's approaching the sequence is,
yeah, it's approaching 0. So 0 is the limit of the sequence, the thing that it's approaching. And then formally you say the limit of a sub n is a representation for the sequence as n approaches infinity. So that means like n is like the number item in the sequence that you're on. So like you could have a sub n could be a1, the first item in the sequence. And n approaches infinity, that means like as you go further and further and further along the sequence, without any, just keep on going and going and going. So as you go further and further along the sequence, the items in the sequence are getting closer and closer to something, and that would be the limit.
Okay.
And then there's like a precise definition of, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, and there's like a precise definition for like what does it precisely mean for the items in the sequence to be getting closer and closer to something, and what it means is that like name any like so let's the limit is so there's some limit L that everything in the sequence is approaching,
right?
If so, for the things to be like approaching L, that means that for any distance you can name, there's some cutoff point in the sequence such that everything after that point is going to be closer to L. So I can like write it on the
whiteboard or on the notepad.
Oh, I guess I'll do it on the whiteboard actually. Okay, it'll be easier to illustrate. Yeah. Like so
maybe a number line.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, I'll do it like this for now. So, like, can you see that?
Where are you on the notepad?
Oh, actually, let me move around to, move.
Try going above the drawings if you can, like.
There. Okay. I think so. Now I'm.
Oh, I see it. I see. Okay.
Great. So I mean, just to check, can you actually, I want to press the draw button. Do you see that?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so like, so the sequence that goes like a1, a2, a3, etc. And yeah, let's just say that these are other items in the sequence. I'll just represent them with these things. Even though there really would be like A4, A5, A6. But like, so all the things in the sequence are getting closer and closer to L. What that means is that like, let's say you want, let's say you pick epsilon. So this E looking thing is a Greek letter epsilon. You pick epsilon to be like 0.01. You're going to be able to find some cutoff point in the sequence, like say here, such that everything beyond that cutoff point is even closer than 0.01 units to L. And then if you make epsilon 0.00000001, you're also going to be able to find a cutoff point in the sequence such that all the items in the sequence beyond that cutoff point are going to be even closer than 0.00001 units.
Closer to kind of the limit.
Yeah, exactly. So in the definition in the book, like the epsilon you can think of as like some level, some number of like a way of measuring closeness. Like the idea is, yeah, what the definition is expressing is that for any distance you can name, there's always going to be some cutoff point in the sequence such that everything beyond there is even closer than that to L. So if the sequence were like, for example, the one I gave earlier, like 1, 1 half, 1 fourth, 1 eighth, 1 16th, and you pick your epsilon to be 0.1, there's going to, like, if everything from 1/16 onwards is closer than 0.1 units to zero, and for any distance you can think of, even if it's 1/1,000,000, you're going to be able to get, at some point, you're going to get far enough in the sequence that everything in the sequence is less than 1/1,000,000 unit away from L. And if it were 1/1,000,000,000, you would also at some point be able to get somewhere in the sequence such that everything beyond that is even closer than 1/1,000,000 of a unit away from the limit. That's the kind of the formal definition of a limit. So like for every epsilon greater than zero, for every distance you can name, there is some integer capital N. And so capital N, we're letting that be like the nth item in the sequence. So there's some capital N such that for all little n greater than capital N, so that means like for any all items in the sequence beyond then the capital nth item, for all those ones, negative epsilon is less than a sub n minus l is less than epsilon. That means that the difference between the items in the sequence and the limit is less than epsilon. Definitely not essential to like understand all of that now, because that would probably come like at the very end of the book, I would guess, because it's advanced and it wouldn't be used at this point. But it's kind of a cool thing to see how that's defined.
Yeah, part of me is actually like hungry to ask more questions about that. But we are alive, so I don't know.
We could also go to the next part on sets.
Let's see here. Did we already do this test yourself?
We haven't done it yet. So we could, might as well do that.
Let's see. Okay, I mean, let's see. Hope you guys in the audience haven't fallen asleep yet. This one, I don't know, this one might be kind of tough. It almost seems like it tests your memory a little bit, but let's see. Conditional statement asserts that if one thing and some other thing. Aloe vera drink. That sounds delicious. Let's see here. Asserts that. Let's see. So, how about this time stuff does two and sushi is the last one? So, these are the important questions because these are the definitions. They'll always be useful. My head's kind of in the way. Maybe I can. see. Given a property that may or may not be true, an existential statement asserts that there is at least one thing which the property is true. Sounds right.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's right. Well done. And we got these other types, the conditional statement and universal statement.
Universal statement asserts that a certain property is true for all elements of a set. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's see here. Conditional statement asserts that if one thing is true, then some other thing also has to be true. Yeah.
Awesome.
Wow.
Huh.
Okay.
Yeah, very well done. You're both doing great. Definitely getting these logical concepts and working very well with variables. Very well done.
Yeah. I feel like a math teacher that has like good math students. They probably just feel right at home. Although I wouldn't mind having like some bad math students. Like, not necessarily bad students, but just like very inexperienced. But nope, only pros have like stopped by so far.
Yeah.
Which is kind of scary because, oh, they hated you. Wow. I feel really? Like, yeah. I feel like they would like you. They'd be like, oh, you know, just give the hard questions to Sushi and call it a day. Well, let's see. Oh, okay. Yeah, it was more of a pride thing, is why they hated you.
Oh, yeah. Alright.
So now I'm thinking of.
I could go to the.
I mean, some of these could be useful. Like. But I don't know, maybe not. Slept through class. Yeah, like the good math students always just sleep through class. I guess it's just. Yeah, the class has to go as slow as, you know, it needs to go to make sure everyone gets it. So if you're really fast, you're probably going to sleep through 80% of it. Let's see. I guess we did enough exercises that we can just glaze over the drills. Yeah, I don't think we'll need to do that. We discussed this content so much too. We can just
Yeah, we can go to the sets here.
Okay, so let's see. We got about 25 more minutes. So, oh, what is this? Answers. Oh, for the test yourself. Cool. So, the language of sets. Let's see. Did you want to read? Yeah, go ahead.
I can read that one. So, when we attempt to express in mathematical symbols a condition proposed in words, first, we understand thoroughly the condition. Second, we must be familiar with the forms of mathematical expression. George Polya. Right. So use of the word set as a formal mathematical term was introduced in 1879 by George Cantor, 1845 to 1918. Most mathematical purposes, we can think of a set intuitively, as Cantor did, simply as a collection of elements, where the elements are just the things in the set. So just a collection of things. For instance, if C is a set of all countries that are currently in the United Nations, then the United States is an element of C. And if I is the set of all integers from 1 to 100, then the number 57 is an element of I. Notation. If S is a set, then X, this kind of E-looking symbol, S, means that X is an element of S, so it's one of the things in the collection. the notation x sum, and then you just put a line through the element symbol s, and that means that x is not an element of s. So it's not one of the things in that collection. A set may be specified using set roster notation by writing all of its elements between braces. For example, the set of 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, 3, denotes the set whose elements are 1, 2, and 3. So one way of representing a set is you can just write a list of all the elements in these curly braces, separating them with commas. A variation of the notation is sometimes used to describe a very large set, as when we write 1, 2, 3, etc., 100, to refer to the set of integer of all integers from 1 to 100. So here we have this, it'll be time-consuming to write them all down, so we just have, you list a few until you get the idea, and then you have just dot, 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 and then list the last one. And it's kind of clear enough what's meant to go in there. A similar notation can also be used to describe an infinite set, because we don't have an eternity to write it down, so we have to write it down in some finite way. As when we write the set of 1, 2, 3, etc., to refer to the set of all positive integers. And the symbol dot 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 is called an ellipsis and is read, and so forth. In that case, the set of 1, 2, 3, and so forth, they listed a few, the first few items in the set, they put the dot, 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 you're supposed to kind of infer, based on what's been listed, what the pattern is, and what the remaining things in the set are going to be. It's kind of an imprecise way of representing a set. It doesn't explicitly say what the things are, but it relies on kind of just recognizing a clear pattern in what's been listed so far. And the axiom of extension says that a set is completely determined by what its elements are, the order in which they might be listed, that some elements are listed more than once. A set is just a collection of things. It's not a collection of things in a certain order. You can think of it as a bag where you've put a bunch of things into the bag. The bag has the things in it, but it doesn't have them in it really in a certain order. If you rearrange the order of the things in the set, that's just, you're still representing the same set. And also, it doesn't matter how many times you write a particular element. The set of 1, 1, 1, 1, and 1 is the same set as the set of 1. You just mentioned one of the elements many times. If you write an element multiple times, that doesn't count as multiple elements. It's just naming the same element multiple times. It's a good thing to keep in mind that the order doesn't matter. The number of times an element is written doesn't matter. What matters is just what the elements are. And now there's an example. So let's do it. Ready, set, go.
Ready, set, go.
Yeah.
Well, let's see. So, with the set stuff, how confident did you guys feel? We've moved on to a new topic. One of the elements of A, B, C. Where are A, B, C?
Has the setup made sense so far? For
the setup? What do you mean?
I'm just saying that for the sake of just the setup for the concept.
Set is too easy of a word to pun off of. Okay, so she's still feeling confident. I wonder at what point would these guys not feel confident? Maybe deep in the book, when there's proofs.
Maybe we'll see.
It's like, let's see here. Okay, well, let's see. Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, these are useful questions for getting with the concepts.
Okay. How about, so then sushi you do the first two, maybe stuff you do the second two. The second two seem kind of tricky, like almost as if
Yeah, those are kind of tricky ones.
I guess.
I see there's an answer for B there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so for this one, yeah, I see why you could think that they are the same, equal, but technically, so the zero on the right is just the number zero. Then the zero on the left, we have the set that's containing zero. So technically, there are two different things. One of them's a number, and the other one's a set, like a collection. You can think of it kind of like if zero is like a marble, the thing on the right is the marble, and then the thing on the left is a bag that has the marble in it.
Okay.
Yeah. So for B, it would be no, because one of them's a set, and another one's a number.
Interesting. So that means that C, this would be two elements then, right? Because the bag of marbles is different from the marble. Oh, I was thinking there were zero zeros in the set. So that's why they were equal.
Oh, yeah.
Apparently the set...
Yeah. Oh yeah, I see why you would think that. But technically, for them to be equal, they would need to be both of them would need to be sets. A set couldn't technically it's considered a set couldn't be equal to a number. To help you, it can be good to think about the container analogy. A set is a container that has something in it. In this case, the left is a bag that has zero in it, and then the right. On the right is just the zero, not in a bag.
Interesting. So, you one, you two.
Yeah. I see what you're thinking. Yeah, that none of them had zero in them. Yeah. So the B was kind of separate from A. In this case. Yeah, see, C, you are right. There are two elements in that set. And the elements, you got the number one, and then you have the set of one is also another element in the set. That's an interesting point that like a set can be an element of another set.
Three elements. That is correct. Okay, so Steph figured out this one, which kind of confused me for a little bit. This is kind of hilarious. This zero, negative zero.
Yeah. Yeah, zero and negative zero. So That's right, and it could also be written as just the set of zero. It's like negative zero equals zero, and so the set of zero and zero equals the set of zero. It's like I'm a set. Oh, no, I spilled soup on yourself. Oh.
Take your time.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Right, since duplicates don't matter in sets.
Yeah.
Neither does the order, so all of these are the same.
Yeah.
And this, I guess you can say, simplifies to this.
Yeah. Yeah, so that one, and yeah, that's right, that all three of those sets, each of them has three elements, those elements would be 1, 2, and 3. And in terms of how those sets are related, they'd be related in that they're equal to each other because they have the same elements.
Right.
So that's illustrating that it doesn't matter the order you write the elements in. It also doesn't matter how many times you write the elements. All that matters is what the elements are. If two sets have the same elements, no matter what order, no matter how many times they're written, then they're equal. They're considered to be the same set.
Hmm. Now, let's see. I wonder if we could look at something. Well, Sushi cleans up that soup. I was thinking about the limits, but you cleaned it up already.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
So let's see. What kind of soup was it? Whitaker, if you had to guess what kind of soup Sushi was eating, what would you guess?
See which one? Yes, soup. Maybe like tomato soup.
I'm gonna guess like chicken soup.
Oh yeah, that's another.
It was. Oh, you were closer. You were correct.
Oh wow! Oh, I'm surprised. Soon. Yeah, tomato soup, that's my favorite kind of soup.
Wow. So let's see here. Certain sets of numbers are so frequently referred to that they are given special symbolic names. These are summarized in the table on the next page. Light tomato soup too, although it is pretty light. It's like a nice snack. Tomato and broccoli, some good protein. Now let's see here. Solin. So symbol set. R is the set of all real numbers. Z is the set of all integers. Q is a set of all rational numbers or quotients of integers. Okay. I wonder if you guys know what real numbers are and what rational numbers are. When I first hopped into this book, I wasn't entirely sure. Do you guys know? and even what integers are. I mean, I know you guys both have like some programming experience. I mean, I guess we could even do it like this if you want. Let's see here.
You know, I could talk about like, yeah, quickly what those are like. So like the. The imaginary numbers are cool.
Interesting. I still gotta review those. So let's see. All right. Well, how about this stuff? You try and tackle that, and Sushi, you try and tackle these. I mean, feel free to use Google if you want, or you can challenge yourself. It matters not. But just like, what are these like? How would you define these to a beginner?
Yeah.
Like this. And I wonder, what would I say?
Yeah, it's kind of hard, like, especially for the real numbers, like, I don't know intuitively what they are, but it's kind of hard to put into words what they are. Kind of...
Right, the hell are they?
Yeah, I know that there are, I haven't really studied it, but there are, like, rigorous, like, definitions, axiomatic definitions of the real numbers in terms of, like, set theory and infinity and stuff, but like, yeah, you know, like what is the intuitive definition of the real numbers?
Yeah, we just needs some casual definitions here. Doesn't have to be super concise. Any number that can be written in a fraction. I think that's right. That's better than what I was gonna say.
Yeah.
Maybe I actually. Yeah, it's a pretty good one. Oh, welcome back, Sushi. Okay. So, try and define these two terms here. I'm afraid I may have actually given you the hard ones. Feel free to use Google if you want to, like, just check yourself. Or you can try and jump in. You're just looking for casual definitions. Numbers that include rational and irrational numbers.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. Yeah, all the rationals and irrationals together would comprise the reals.
Oh, okay. Whole numbers. Nice, nice. Very clean. Wow. Yeah. Hey, you guys are good. I was struggling with this one. I'm giving out tests that I'm struggling with. So let's see.
Yeah, it's worth talking a bit about these definitions. So like the rational numbers, so they can be written as fractions. Another way of putting that is quotients of integers. Like one integer over another. That's why they're called rational, because like a fraction can also be called a ratio.
Right.
So 0.5 can be written as a fraction because it can be written as 1/2. Any number that can be written as a fraction of we have an integer in the numerator and an integer in the denominator. Yeah, the integers, whole numbers. They're whole in the sense that they're like any of them can be written as like something .0. It would be like the ordinary counting numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. And also the negatives of those: -1, -2, -3, -4, -5. Then also 0. So those would be the integers. And then, yeah, the real numbers that would include all the rational numbers as well as the irrational numbers, like the square root of 2 or pi, it can't be written as fractions of real number or of integers. And the real numbers, you can also, it's kind of like any kind of amount of something that you can like easily imagine, like be considered a real number, like any positive real number, be imagined as like the length of something, any possible length you could imagine corresponds to a positive real number. You can also think of it like that. The rational and the irrational numbers together, those would you'd have all the real numbers with those together.
Okay. So like with the real numbers, you're saying a length of something. So if I were to go to the whiteboard, what do you mean? Is it something that can be easily shown with like a number line?
I guess I don't know with a number line, but I guess I'm just trying to think of like another way of defining like intuitively what the real numbers are. I was thinking like you could say like positive real numbers, those are like, they correspond to any possible length you could have, I guess. Like something could be 1 unit long, it could be half a unit long, it could be the square root of 2 units long. So I guess it's like they're all numbers that kind of would make sense for a length, I guess. They're heading out for today's stuff. Thank you so much for joining us. You're definitely doing a great job getting these concepts.
Yep, thanks for stopping by, Steph. Actually reminded me that we are pretty much at the end of the stream anyway.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So, let's see.
It's great to have you here, and hope you have a wonderful rest of the day.
Yep. Let's see. We do have another stream this week, Wednesday. If you guys want, feel free to join the Discord. Follow the Twitter. But yeah, I suppose we can wrap up for today. Let's see. How'd you guys feel? Was it a pretty good session? I know I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, me too.
Yep. Also, thanks for like crashing our stream, Sushi. That was pretty awesome. Would definitely like to see you again.
Yeah. Thanks so much for coming.
Indeed.
I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Got pretty good distance. Now let's see. Yep, please show up when you can. That is all we ask. But that is pretty much it for today. I mean, I guess we'll just start back here next time.
Yeah, sounds great.
So let's see. Yeah. In that case, we'll see you guys later.
See you later, and thank you for coming, and good night.
Good night, y'all.
Okay, so...